ignorance is the only problem on earth. The solution is understanding, because understanding brings peace. The truth sets you free. The seven Hermetic Principles allow us to understand the nature of reality. The universe is a field of clay scattered with diamonds. Pyramids are diamonds in a field of clay. The Hermetic Principle of Correspondence states that as above, so below. Infinite space and singularity are opposite states of the same condition. Between these two states is the process of creation as we know it, generated by the extreme contrast, causing a vibration in the great subtle cosmic ocean of energy in space, known as Tiamat in the Sumerian creation epics. Polarity is generated from the great cosmic ocean in space. Which generates rhythm throughout the levels of correspondence in a galaxy. Rhythm is process, and process is growth and refinement in a feedback loop. There is cause and effect. Planets grow creatures and life, which is gender. The creature has the ability to regenerate the creator of the system that generated them. In so doing, by an act of mentalism, the individual is reborn as spirit and freed from the matrix of the creation. The seven Hermetic Principles are satisfied by the creation cycle. They conform to the 7 days of creation in the book of Genesis. When we take the biological systems together as the capstone of the galaxy, understanding is attained through direct contact with the divine, and your pyramid turns into a diamond. A galaxy is a fruit tree yielding fruit whose seed is in itself. As a loop of conscious participation, the galactic process can be likened to a Möbius strip and the never-ending staircase of M.C. Escher. When we compare the conditions of creation to the Renaissance painting Ascent of the Virgin by Titian, the Renaissance painter, we find correspondence with the underworld identified as being between heaven and the manifest world. The cloud in the painting is the creator light, the diamond of the goddess. She is creation itself, physically and spiritually as Pistis Sophia. Her son is the diamond of her clay. He is the sword of truth from the waters of chaos. The light of illumination can only be conceived by union with God in the individual. As Sophia, We are the bride who marries God as the bridegroom. This is when the Holy Spirit comes to you, when you know of God's presence directly. Your marriage is consummated to produce a divine child, born in the house of bread, which in Hebrew is Bethlehem. The human head is the house of bread. In this Renaissance painting of the Annunciation by Carlo Crivelli, we can see the divine child as a cloud of light in the sky beaming down to the Virgin who is going to conceive a divine child. The cloud has three layers, like the human brain, and God thrice great, from the center of which projects a golden beam directly into the head of the Virgin. The dove, used to represent the Holy Spirit in this case, can be found in alchemical symbolism. The purpose of showing us a divine child already made at its own annunciation is a way of recording the cyclic nature of creation, in that the Creator already exists at the root of the galactic tree. The painting is halved to emphasize the duality of near and far, like the two operations of the brain. On the right we see the completed tree of life as the two columns with the queen in the middle. In this sense, the dove now represents the light at the top of the tree, and so it has beams coming from it. Above we can see a peacock, who also represents the eye of illumination. On the left is a vanishing point in the distance, highlighting the need to contract your intellect to a single point when the Holy Spirit is in you. To realize the oneness of all things in poignant definition is to reproduce the light in yourself. The Philosopher's Stone is the product in alchemy, as the Divine Child is the product of your union with God. They are one and the same thing. Its colors are black, white, and red, since it exists in a pitch-black, vacuous space, the underworld, as a white cloud, bleeding its lifeblood as light in all directions, so it's symbolically red. It is its own mother, formed into a perfection of the chaotic waters of subtle energy in space. In this way, the light can be represented by a mother or an elder woman. It is the slain Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. The Last Supper is black, white, and red to commemorate the risen light in the house of bread as good wine. The light is the fourth singular condition to emerge from the triad of infinities as a physical creation, even though it exists timelessly as they do as non-physical issues. It's the bridge between heaven and hell, the underworld. It's Hades, and the light is ruler over all that is under heaven. Therefore he rules over hell as Hades and creation together, since creation can be considered severe, and thus its creator must be severe himself. He is the opposite of God, who is spirit. Physical is opposite to spirit, as Shakti is to Shiva. And yet he is born a divinity as the Son of God. The light, then, has two interpretations at once. One is the spiritual and the other physical. The opposer of God is Satan. His name is Lucifer, as the title Lightbringer. Satan and Lucifer are thus one and the same thing. They are both the Creator. As a product of the Creator, a human being is said to be a child of the devil before they become a child of God. Since creation and the underworld are of Hades and hell, it is said that a child of the devil will be reborn in hell. This simply means that if a person dies as a child of the Creator, they will rebirth again into creation. If they have become a child of God before death, they are already in heaven and no longer need to rebirth in creation. They are absorbed back to God in death. In John chapter 3 verse 5, Jesus is quoted as saying, "No one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying you need to be born again." Water and spirit refer to the heart and mind in the human being. Their centers are where the two keys to heaven are metaphorically inserted to open the kingdom of heaven to you on earth. They are the keys of death and Hades, the gold and silver of the sun and the moon, whose eclipse symbolizes the birth of the light in the house of bread. We can only recreate the Creator in ourselves when we have risen above the physical level, in conscious union with the divine, where its spirit floods us in the calm stillness of heaven, and we are born in water. Baptism is merely a commemoration of this event. Subsequently, by an act of mentalism, we unify the duality of opposites in our understanding, as we find the singular truth itself, that all is one. Matter comes from spirit and yet generates liberation back to spirit. They are intertwined and cause each other. The flood of the Holy Spirit has given birth to you as spirit, and you have produced the waters of life, known also as the fountain of youth. As such, you are reborn as a fish out of water, depicted as Oannes the fish god. From Oannes we derive the name John, whose gospel talks about rebirth in water. The name Oannes is derived from the Hebrew name Yochanan, meaning Yahweh is gracious. Yahweh is Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, the creator light. 7,000 years ago in Babylonian mythology, this was a god named Ea or Enki. Ea was a water god, since he is the waters of life. He is the water bearer known as Aquarius in astrology, who pours out the waters of life as the light of illumination. He was depicted with the upper body of a man and the lower body of a fish known as Dagon to the Philistines. The root meaning of DGN in Ugaritic is grain, hence Dagon became associated with agriculture. However, grain can symbolically refer to the new seed produced by spiritual liberation. Dagon personified natural forces that had supposedly produced all things as a fish man who holds out the pine cone in association with the pineal creator light. He holds a pine cone at a distance in front of his face, at eye level, as if he were looking at the pineal cloud itself. He also holds a bag of pollen, since he is a farmer who now sows seeds to the field of humanity. This Assyrian cylinder seal shows Dagon next to a burning bush on the ground, depicted as a small tree with an erect phallus at its core, under an eye in the sky. There are 13 flames in the bush to represent the brain with the light at the top in the middle, surrounded by 12 cranial nerves. On the left we see an angelic reference to the person in this event who is being born again in spirit from water, waving at the man on the right who represents God receiving his prodigal son. Now the work of creation is done. We also see a flying eye in the sky above. The feathers of the bird-like wings protruding from the eye are arranged like the beams from the cloud of light as they protrude normal or perpendicular from its distinct squared-off surfaces. The Sumerian sky god emblem is then the light of spiritual rebirth and not a flying saucer, as many claim. In Sumer, a god was called Anunnaki, since it means princely offering, or princes of Anu on earth. An or Anu is the father of life in the galaxy, referring to the creator at the center of creation. When you recreate that creator, you are elevated above it in spirit. For the rest of your mortal life, you are a god, or child prince of An or Anu, since the creator has prepared you for rebirth by giving you flesh. The word Nun is embedded in the title and means fish or prince. You are a fish when born in spirit from water, and a prince that becomes a king when returned to the body as a god. You are also on earth, which is the Naki of the title. Hence, Anunnaki, then, is not an alien. It's an illuminated spiritual being. A god on earth is a hero who slays the dragon. The self-identification with purely physical existence has given way to the spiritual reality. The hero is a spiritual being who has fought with himself and won. The physical is seen for what it is, a mere illusion, an expression that allowed the hero to become as such and know his true self. This process is known in alchemy as the Great Work. Using astrological symbolism, the Great Work is the 12 labors of Hercules that sees a psyche unified with its true greater self. Once complete, the psyche is unified with its own crucifixion on the Great Cross, highlighted by four constellations: Aquarius, Taurus, Leo, and Scorpio. In this desert figure from Atacama in Chile, we see 12 spikes projecting from the head of the figure as if they are beams projecting from the square-shaped light of illumination. He holds a club in the position of one of the beams from the front of the light when you first see it. This is the club of dominion over physical forces, since the light is the creator of all life in the galaxy. Vishnu appears in the three colors of being in alchemy. Yellow is the mentality, red the emotion and passion, and blue is the physical content of being. From the navel of Vishnu grows a lotus plant whose flower is Brahma, the great product of the creative realm, the light of illumination. Alchemists believe that the basis of the material world was a prima materia, or prime chaotic matter. Psychologically, prima materia is identical to an undifferentiated, disintegrated, chaotic, unconscious mind containing all the potential, the dynamic oppositions necessary to achieve the goal of the opus. The elements are often represented anthropomorphically by male and female, but also in terms of planets and their corresponding metals. These elements are then grouped into opposites, which are brought together in a union. The product of this union then dies to produce the blackening of the nigredo. The blackening is about depression, the melancholia that is often the initial stage causing one to slow down and examine life, that brings one into therapy. It deepens when one encounters the shadow side of personality. The encounter with the shadow is invariably experienced as a mortificatio. The dark shadow aspects of the self have to be confronted and assimilated into consciousness. Feelings of guilt, worthlessness, and powerlessness have to be suffered, taken on, and worked through. As a prelude to resolving conflicts and warring elements in the psyche, a cleansing process is required involving an examination and withdrawal of projections. The Nigredo stage was known by the alchemists to be dangerous. In alchemical language, matter suffers until the Nigredo disappears and a new day dawns. The material slowly starts coming back to life. At the moment of death, the soul is released, refined, and then reunited with the revitalized materia to produce the glorious stage of many colors, called the peacock's tail, which then transforms into white, albedo, and contains all colors like white light. Jung compared it with daybreak, the preparation from the next and final stage, which is the sunrise. To make the opus come alive into full human mode of existence, it must have blood, or what alchemists call the rubedo, or redness of life. In this final stage, the white becomes united with red through the raising of the heat in the fire. The white is associated with the queen and the red with the king, who now arise out of the mercurial transformative waters of the unconscious to perform their conjunctio oppositorum, the union of all opposites symbolized by the conjunction of the archetypal masculine and feminine in the chemical marriage, the Heros Gamos. This results in the grand climax, the achievement of the goal, the Lapis Philosophorum. The Hermaphite embodying the united king and queen. This is the so-called third thing, the rebus, the phenomenon of the union of love and soul itself. The soul that is engendered through love. This divine birth symbolizes a reawakening of psychological reality, a new ruling consciousness. This inner treasure was most commonly referred to as the Philosopher's Stone. If we compare the prima materia with the original raw state of consciousness from which all states of consciousness emerged, we can view the Philosopher's Stone as the state of illuminated consciousness whilst in the earthly body.